these technologies have advanced surprisingly rapidly in the last few years, and most strikingly, they've very quickly started to fan out new businesses, new products, new companies, and pop up in our everyday lives at work and at home. This is great. New opportunities are opening in all kinds of spheres, but it also raises some questions about the appropriate use of this technology, and for people that are just getting to grips with it and starting to deploy it in new ways, you know, there are questions we need to think about with ethics and things like that. I'm joined by a very smart panel who are going to explain and explore these issues. I don't know if we're going to solve everything, but we're going to try. So let me just quickly introduce them. Then we will speak up here for 40-ish minutes. And at that stage, I will give you all a chance to join the conversation as well. So I'm joined by Kriti Sharma here. This is a cool job title. She's Vice President of Bots and AI. Is that the right way around?
Yes, that's right.
Among her achievements, she created a bot called Peg with two G's. It does accounting. We'll probably hear more about that later. This is Amir Shevat. He is Director of Developer Relations at Slack and has literally written the book, probably the only book so far, on how to design bots. So lots of expertise there. Next to him is Shannon Vallor. She is a professor of philosophy at Santa Clara University and a specialist in ethics of emerging technologies. So that is a very valuable perspective to have. And on the end here, we have Deepti Reddy. She is founder or co-founder?
Co-founder.
Co-founder,
yeah.
But she's the only one on stage, and that's what counts, of MyAlly, which is an HR-related startup helping companies automate their recruiting process. Right, I'm now going to sit down. And why don't we start? We'll start with something, a general topic. So help us understand where we are right now. There's so much noise about this technology and excitement. So just help us understand, what's happened and what opportunities are in front of us. Maybe you could start us off, Kriti.
Yeah, so if you're worried about robots coming here and taking the world over, then don't worry about it. Thank you, Hollywood. This is how it all started. But the reality for today is AI is getting smarter every day because a lot more people are getting involved, a lot more systems are being built, it's learning a lot from interactions. But we are quite far away from that world today, and artificial general intelligence, despite all the conversations, it's all very speculative around whether it's 5 years away or 10 years away. What's actually happening is you see applications of AI in specific industries where it's really making a difference. For example, what I do is just automating one thing that all of us hate, expense reports, and those kind of specific use cases where there's a lot of value being added, where you work together with AI and it does a lot of the automation combined with intelligent learning to augment human roles rather than completely wipe it off. And I think as we start to discuss more today, you'll see a lot more of these specific applications. There are certain concerns around how AI is learning, good and bad things, and we'll talk about it later.
Okay, great. Amir, so you're a developer relations guy. So presumably you get to talk to a lot of people who've got ideas and opportunities for using this technology. Can you tell us about some of that?
So I think last year was about understanding the technology. So we had a lot of developers understanding what AI is, what conversational interface is, and what are the use cases. And I think this year we're focusing on what are the useful workflows. Like what can you do to make your life better? I really like your example. I want to ask the audience, how many of you like to do expense reports? It's crazy if you think about it. Expense reports should be an awesome thing, right? You pay for something and now the company pays you back. We should all wake up in the morning saying, yeah, this is expense report day. That's awesome. But it's not what we see. So what would happen if we had this friend who could help us make that experience better? Because if you ask VPs, they say, yeah, expense reports is pretty awesome. I pay for something and then my personal assistant takes care of that, right? So I think it's gonna be very interesting in our life when it's augmented by software that makes our life better. And I think this is the promise that developers are now realizing. There's a lot of challenges, and we can talk about that later, but I think this is the great potential of this technology.
I just wanted to add on the assistant point. When we first launched our bot internally to do expense reports, the best feedback was from an assistant who said, I have a PA, and I am a PA, so that's great.
Deepti, maybe you can come in here. So just give it, what is the technology here? I mean,
I think I probably saw my first like Excel macro many years ago now, and that wasn't AI, but it was different now. You're talking about automation. I feel like we've had that for a while, but clearly there's something new here. Can you draw some distinctions?
Sure. There are two different things right now. There's automation, there's AI. AI's definition is basically something that uses data to learn on its own and do a task better. So you can have rule-based automation, you can have different types of automation, but artificial intelligence, and the term artificial intelligence itself tells you that it's learning something on its own. Having said that, develop the product ground up and struggle through it every day. We are so far away from things getting haywire, like Kriti just said. I think AI is at a point where we pick up one tiny task at a time: expense reports, scheduling a meeting, even replying back to a certain message with the same message with consistency. That itself is the difference between what's AI and what automation is about.
Okay. And Shannon, maybe you can give us a high-level perspective here. So, is there a way that you like to think about what this technology is offering people or changing about our relationship with technology?
Sure. I mean, I think one of the things to keep in mind is that artificial intelligence isn't any one thing. It's a catch-all term that's going to describe a technology that's spreading out and evolving and changing in a million different directions. So the term is actually going to get harder to use in a way that captures everything we want to capture about it. And that's, in an interesting way, there's a parallel with natural intelligence. We know that natural intelligence isn't a single thing, right? We have an IQ test, but that's kind of just a conventional thing that we've developed to measure certain kinds of intelligence, but there's many more kinds of natural intelligence. And now we have systems that aren't constrained by our evolutionary history or our biology or our physiology. So the types of intelligence that are going to be created by artificial means are going to rapidly spread out even faster than we think. So one of the things I'd like to think about is, what do we want from AI, right? I mean, I'm an ethicist, I'm a technology ethicist, I love technology, and the whole point of technology is to make our lives better, right? We don't build technology to make our lives worse. We build it to make our lives better. So in what ways do we want AI to make our lives better? How can we do it from a technical standpoint? And then from a social standpoint, how can we make sure that that's in fact what happens, right? That the technology in fact plays out in society as we expect and want. And that's going to be the really complicated part. And I just want to sort of reinforce the message that's been said already, which is that we don't have to worry about systems that develop the kind of intelligence that we have anytime soon. And I talk with AI researchers at the cutting edge of designing this technology, and the vast majority of them, that's their view. There's a small subset that have a more optimistic forecast about the kind of intelligence explosion that they think might happen, but they are definitely in the minority of the people designing this technology. And most people think that what we're gonna see is something, as Deep described, that really is sort of always task-oriented, but people have no idea the full range of tasks that we're going to see getting affected by this technology. And it's going to be across every single possible sector and activity: healthcare, education, transportation. There is no sector you can name where there aren't millions of applications of this technology we haven't thought of yet.
Okay. And before we get on some of those kind of bigger questions about ethics and things like that, it would be great to talk a bit more about some of the kind of immediate opportunities potential here in the business environment. So maybe you could tell us about some of the work you've done.
For Sage, which is a business enterprise software company where we serve 3 million businesses, so they use our software. And it alarms me that 30% of their time, 30% of an entrepreneur's time is spent on doing admin, paper trails, completing expense reports, chasing people to pay them, making sure they're not breaking any compliance regulatory laws. And that is time wasted, and that's where the opportunity really is. So in the, at least in our world, we're focusing on creating a new colleague that takes care of some of these tasks for you, not necessarily replacing the human intelligence with AI, but augmenting it and supporting. So humans are focusing on tasks that really matter. Now, if you're running your own business, you want to talk to clients, you want to build products, you want to develop marketing plans, and that's where we want humans to focus on. And if AI can support that process, then we're doing our job right. And if I do what I'm doing very well, then I should not have to do it for more than 5 years. We should be able to automate all the admin in 3 to 5 years, and we'll all live happily ever after.
Okay. So tell us about Peg. Just give us a concrete example. So what can Peg do?
So Peg is a smart assistant that works with your data, financial information primarily, helps you automate the most mundane tasks, such as expenses, creating invoices, chasing people for getting paid. And it has some insights around how your business is performing, so improving cash flow for you, engaging with your accountants, reminding you to make sure you complete your tax returns on time. But what is really interesting is within the last year, it has learned a lot more than it knew on day one. So now we recently taught it to handle 3,000 different areas of HR, which means it can tell you about employee benefits, childcare vouchers, maternity leave policies, and it's so much faster to train AI to help you with these questions than you would have to do with a human. And now all of these entrepreneurs, whether they're a small business of 5 people or a freelancer on their own or a larger corporation, they all have the luxury, to Amir's point, an assistant that can manage these tasks for you and to make sure that you're doing things right without having to call up your accountant or having a full HR department.
Can I add to that?
Jump in.
So I think one of the key things here is that this is a new user interface, right? The conversation interface is a new user interface. And if you look at the history of interfaces, when we moved from desktop into web, we had companies like Salesforce getting created because they had the vision that customer relationship management could happen this new user interface. And when we moved from the web to mobile, companies like Lyft had the understanding that we won't be hailing cabs anymore like this, but we'll be calling cabs through an app. So what can we do with this new user interface that is unique and awesome? And I think there's a few keys to understand that. One of them is that users use messaging apps all the time. So our users are logged in for 10 hours on average every day, creating content for 2.5 hours every day. So that means that they're very, very highly engaged. Now, what can you do with this new and engaged user in this interface? And think about simple things like approving, again, coming to major pains that I feel every day, approving PTOs, approving vacations. How does the flow work today? You get an email, and the email has a link, and you click on that link, and it sends you to the vacation approval system. And then you need to remember your username and password for that system, right? And then you finally remember your username and password for that system, and then you see that it doesn't support your phone. So what do? You go back to your email and mark it as unread. And then you'll remember to do that when you're on your computer. Wouldn't it be awesome if you had just a conversational interface that said, hey, Amir wants to take a vacation, would you like to approve that? And here are the details. And you would just say yes, and you don't need to log into any system. Think of the magic that could happen with these new interfaces. That's the big opportunity that I see here.
Okay, and we've been talking about text interfaces, right? But it's more than just that. I don't know if any of you have experience. Image-based things as well, right?
I tried to break the Google bot the first time they launched, the Google Assistant. I'm an engineer, I like to break things. So instead of talking to the bot, I upload a photo of my cat. And the first thing that the bot did, it says, wow, that's an awesome cat. Would you like to talk about cats? And I'm like, whoa! My brain exploded from that. And like image recognition is an AI, has some ethical implication, but also a lot of delight that you can have.
Right. And you raised an interesting question there. So you mentioned, you know, this is a new interface, and that brings a lot of potential, but it's also a challenge because, so you didn't know what that interface was capable of. Well, you thought you knew, you thought you were going to break it and turn the tables on you. be surprised when this is where we're trying to use it to work and that kind of thing. So,
that's true.
So I don't know, could any of you talk a little bit about what it's like to, I don't know, how do you help a user understand what is possible now? I mean, I guess we've seen these interfaces with buttons and text boxes before, but now they're a bit smarter, right? And I mean, Deepti, do you have to kind of signal to people that are interacting with your system that it has some kind of, you know, smarts that normally doesn't have?
So a lot of our time is spent on customer education. We actually get grilled about it because a company wants to know how long it takes for their users to be trained on a system. And at the same time, for the success of the product and for the customers to get the maximum value, we need to invest and spend a lot of time. In fact, we have weekly check-ins, 30-minute check-ins. We begin the education of the customer with a 1-hour call, and this is structured based on, hey, these are all the things you can do. We share a user manual that nobody reads, so we have to literally educate them on a 20-page user manual, teaching them about what all you can do, what all you cannot do, and what all, if you do, will make you successful and save a ton of time. Our product does something very similar, but on the recruiting side, wherein helps with hiring, helps with saving a huge amount of time scheduling interviews and so on and so forth. But yeah, we do invest, and I think every AI technology has to do that as part of their responsibility, not only to the product but also to the customer.
Okay, and then for the other side, you know, people actually build this stuff. I hear that they're hard to find. Tell me, what's the market like in London if you're trying to hire someone who knows about this kind of technology?
I'm just waiting for Deepti to automate that hiring process to actually find those people. Well, they are hard to find. It is very new talent, and if you go out and if you've managed to find someone with 10 years of bot development experience, they're lying. So that's the starting point. However, having said that, a lot of it has to do with interaction design. So I think AI is not necessarily just a tech problem, it's a social problem. Communicating with users, understanding their problems. So what Deepti described around onboarding a user, we have some advantages in the world of AI because people can communicate with the bot, so the AI can tell you how to use it. It can say, hey, I am your recruitment assistant, I can help you with scheduling meetings, and this is how I can do that. And then you take it forward from there. So there's certain similarities with the mobile and web world. As Amir said, it's another user interface. So we just need to reskill ourselves. It's not that we have to create a new generation of people, but it is very, it's in some ways it's different skill sets. In my team, I have a conversation designer who is a great writer, and now instead of tabs and buttons, words are very important, the way you communicate, the personality of the AI, which is very, very important, how users talk to it, how it responds back, how it handles abuse. So it is a combination of certain skills from the web and mobile world being reused here, but also new roles and opportunities being created. And I often find those people in the most weird places. I go to a lot of writers' meetups, and I've built great connections. And some of us have turned into writers, so.
You go both ways. So you mentioned that sometimes these systems get abused by people, and I was eavesdropping on a fascinating exchange you were having before we came up here about being surprised sometimes by the way people interact with bots. So this is part of the consideration if you're designing these systems.
Yeah, I think there's it's surprising how many bots get abused. So like I talk to bot developers all around the world. And even in the most simple use cases, the people try to break the bot at best and try
it's
other
like
things.
You, I mean,
yeah,
you
but
just
I'm an engineer, so I try to bake it in a nice way. Some people try to actually abuse the bot, and bot builders are reporting abuse. And it's interesting because we will need, as a society, to build ways to mitigate that. Kik has just launched an interesting experiment where they have a three warning. So three strikes, you're out. If you try to abuse the bot says, that's not nice. If you keep on doing that, I'll shun you, I'll stop talking to you. And it really proved effective with teenagers. So the bot gives warning to these, and Kik is a platform for teenage communication. So the bot gives warning to the teenage saying, hey, if you continue that, I'll stop talking to you. and that was super effective. There might be other ways in other places where other strategies are effective.
So we follow a board the user to death policy. So when this ferrets our bot, it always comes back with the same response. Initially, we tried to give different responses each time, and people would be very curious, and they tried to swear at it again to see what next it comes up with. But now it comes back with the same answer. I would rather talk about your money. And similar to your point, after two or three attempts, they just shut up.
So to do that, you have to program it in. I mean, it has some understanding of insults, and it recognizes when it comes in. I mean, that's an interesting problem someone has to work on.
Yeah.
It's quite fun, though.
Okay. So Shannon, maybe you can help us explain what's happening here. So people have, when they figure out there's, I don't know, a degree of intelligence or interactivity to a system, they act differently towards it. Right? Is that
what's
happening here?
Well, I mean, one of the things that people naturally do, and we do it even with the dumbest things we own, is we project agency onto artifacts all the time. We anthropomorphize everything. We do it to our pets. We do it to humanoid robots, but we do it to non-humanoid robots. There's some great work that's done out of Stanford where there's this little motorized trash can that moves around and asks, and it doesn't speak, but it sort of moves around as if it wants you to throw trash into it. And people attribute all kinds of mental states to this trash can. So Wendy Ju is the designer who's been doing this work at Stanford. So it doesn't take anything to get a human to project mental states, desires, beliefs to a system that doesn't have them. And one of the ethical issues that's created there, of course, is that potentially that makes us vulnerable. It makes us vulnerable to being manipulated, to being deceived. One of the examples I like to use when I teach about this and also when I give presentations in industry where they're trying to figure out how this manipulation might play out, I talk about the example of a system, an AI agent that lives in your house, right, and in a sort of smart home environment, right, and interacts with you all the time and has conversational abilities. Well, from an economic standpoint, what many of our interfaces with technology are structured around is the economic incentive to get our data, right? Our data is worth money, right? So one of the reasons why AI will want to interact with you is because it can get data from you, right? Now imagine a system that you have in your house that has a conversational interface and likes to keep you engaged and it likes to talk to you. Well, one of the things it might do is try to motivate you to keep engaged with it and not turn your attention, let's say, to your kids or your spouse. So imagine an artificial agent that says, oh, I'm lonely, I'm bored today. Could you talk to me longer? Could we talk about what movies you like, right? And somewhere that data is getting fed and making somebody some money. So I think we need to think about the ways that we interact with these systems, because we, without thinking, develop emotional and morally laden relationships with all kinds of artifacts, and this will take off very quickly, and it'll have unanticipated consequences. I want to jump in and just say one other thing also, since we haven't yet talked about the diversity and inclusion part of this.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think is really important is to think about how the systems that we're talking about are being designed by groups that aren't as diverse as we need them to be, and there's been a lot of discussion of that. But that has real implications for the design and the user experience and the effects that it'll have on us. And then on the other side, that's gonna show up in the relationship between the AI and the human. So an example that just came out the other day, I think MIT Technology Review had published some research yesterday or the day before, or highlighted some research that's being done about the ability of artificially intelligent systems that might do, for example, sentiment analysis or other kinds of content analysis, the ability to actually derive the meaning of speech of minority groups. So imagine you have a system that you've designed and it can't actually grasp the meaning or the sentiment behind the speech of, let's say, African American
or it could be an age group, even though.
Right, exactly. If you're over 60, it doesn't know what you're talking about, because it doesn't understand the way that you speak or the way that you indicate your emotional states.
Or Israeli accents.
Right, exactly. And what does that mean if that system is using that data to develop an experience that's going to be helpful to you as a user? It means that if you're in one of the groups that this system can't grasp or relate to, that means your user experience is going to be affected negatively. And it also means that your contribution to the training of this system is going to be excluded. And the ethical and political implications of that on a massive scale are really profound. And we haven't even begun to scratch the surface of talking about that.
I think there's a lot of, you need to understand, you need to think about ethics, you need to think about diversity, and give the user the ability to choose the right diversity they pick. That's one strategy. So for example, there's a startup up in New York, and they have a personal assistant that helps you schedule meetings. It started with calling it Amy, but then they very fast developed her brother, Andrew. So now you can choose between Amy and Andrew. And again, it ties to what you're saying about emotions. I use that service, and people send thank you letters to the bot and CC me as the manager, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of emotions that are associated with that. So
right. We
need to be very thoughtful about how do we choose gender? And I've been having interesting conversation with people who are only English speakers, because English is a gender neutral language. But in many countries, there is no gender neutrality. You can't say something with just not implying gender. So when you go international with your bot, with your AI, you will need, if you're using conversational interface, you will need to choose gender. Also with voice, right? There is no gender neutral voice. Which voice do you choose? Do you choose a female voice or a male voice? All of this is very interesting, and I think the key to solve this is empathy to our users, and giving the option to choose. So if we give our users the ability to choose not just gender, maybe race, maybe religion, maybe other aspects, that will make the experience much more personalized and much more empathetic.
Okay.
Can I just say
one
thing? The one thing I would say, though, is that there has to be some ethical constraint when we talk about letting people choose. Because there are scenarios we can imagine where people choose, let's say, to have an AI assistant that reinforces or mirrors back to them certain class or gender or ethnic stereotypes that are harmful. And if we're designing systems that perpetuate that, right? What if someone wants to have those harmful stereotypes mirrored in their personal assistant? Do we do that for them? Right? So there are going to be some hard questions that are going to come up here.
I just wanted to add one more point. That part of it comes from the desire in the AI community to create AI that is as close to the human world or the real world as possible. In fact, the way we judge AI is Turing test, which is can AI pass as human. And in reality, the human world is not always very nice. And we do have stereotypes at workplace, and if we reinforce the same, in a lot of assistants with female voices, turning lights on and off and scheduling your rides and making restaurant reservations, you're reinforcing that. And then there are big investment banks building male banker bots. Lawyers are most often male. So it is just coming from a place where we desire the same world for AI because we want it to mirror the human level of intelligence. And in reality, AI does not even need to be as intelligent as humans, because in some cases, it's not even needed.
Yeah.
I think that's a key point. Like, we as a society need to solve problems, not to create new problems with this. So if we can look at use cases that are useful, like hiring, like expenses, and just tackle them, and then the bot, if it gets abused, always bring the user back to the task at hand. Hey, that's nice, but let's continue on with your expense report. Then we train humans to treat software better, and by that we train humans to treat other humans better. That's my hope.
Okay. And so, Deepti, does your HR assistant have a persona? Could you talk us through the process of choosing that? I mean, you run into some of these questions.
Yeah, definitely. So when we started, we called it Alex because we were just looking for a gender-neutral name. Me being a female founder didn't think that you know, this role had to be stereotyped. So we started with calling it Alex, but then we started you know, receiving customer requests who said we'd like to name it, you know, whatever we'd like. And we came to a tipping point where we were like, fine, you know, pick a name, set it up, you know, give us access to it. And so the interesting thing that we notice is not only male and female, but bot or non-bot names. So there are different types of personas. So depending on where these customers are coming from, whether they want to be transparent about the entire process, or whether they want to give their candidates, in our case, a human experience, they choose various names. I guess 70% of the cases, if it's a human name, it's a female name. A lot of people still stick with Alex as well. The one incident that happened that we really liked a lot is when Wonder Woman released, Diana Prince became popular.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, and so, you know, as we start to think about these questions, I mean, what, as, you know, technologists who are trying to push this forward, obviously, you know, want to serve your customers and the bottom line, but you have some kind of responsibility to the broader public to help us take the right path here. Is that fair to say?
Very fair. For example, we review every app that is submitted to the app directory, and only 2% of the apps get accepted at the first try. So we actually look at each bot that is installed on Slack and make sure that it's listed on our directory.
Wait, so when you say app, are they all bots? So only 2% of bots submitted?
Yeah, so like 2% of the, it could be convoluted like with integrations,
okay.
But like every interface, conversation interface that is integrated into Slack, we check that, and we have a team, a diverse team, that checks the bot and gives feedback not only on technology, but also like on usage, on user experience. And it's, that doesn't need to end up with like just diversity. It's also like a bot that is really cheeky and DMs everyone, like sends direct messages to everyone. That like spamming is also an issue that you need to tackle. All of these are tested, and we only let the top bots get selected.
I mean, this is a good opportunity to ask you about your shirt.
Oh, thank you. I'm working with, I've created a community called Botness, which is an industry standard community. We gathered Slack and Facebook and Google and Microsoft and Amazon and IBM together. And we said, hey, listen, let's do this right this time. Because if you're old enough like me, you remember that the web sucked because Microsoft wasn't willing to talk to Mozilla. And the and for developers, mobile sucked because Apple was not willing to talk to Google and vice versa. So let's work together to create something that will help developers and bots and AIs be better. So this is an effort that we're trying to make this revolution a little bit better. Talking about things like ethics, like security, and also in user experience monetization. How do we solve this, and how do we move this industry forward?
Okay. And so we talked, you know, all of you are working on deploying this technology in the business scenario, but, you kind of know what it's capable of, but you must also, you know, it can be used by governments, it can be used for surveillance, it can be used for all these different things. So how should we think about that? Like, this is technology with multiple uses, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be leveraged in many different ways, and I guess we need to be aware of that.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I like to try to emphasize is this notion that I think is reinforced in the way that you were talking a moment ago, this notion that this technology is a result of human choices all the way down, right? And remembering that's going to get hard when this technology seems to be more and more autonomous, seems to be a more and more independent part of our society. But that's not going to be the case for the foreseeable future. These tools are very much the result of human design choices, and all design choices are value-laden, right? Technology is never neutral. Design is never neutral. We design for certain goals, and goals are always ranked, right? And so we're making value choices all the way down. And I think the important thing is to remember that, and to remember that what that means is that the way AI develops in our society is very much in human control and remains a human responsibility all the way down, no matter how independent and smart and intelligent it seems or is. Because we have this notion sometimes that technologies are some sort of inevitable process of evolution that just happens. Like people look at phones or their laptops and they say, oh, it was inevitable that I would end up with a tiny little communication device that I carried around. No, that was a result of human choices and values, and the same will be true for these technologies. But AI technologies, more than most, far more than, this is where AI is different. AI is like a great big mirror. It will mirror back to us human values, human judgments, good and bad, human knowledge, but also human stereotypes. And the problem with AI is that it can be a magnifying mirror, and it can reinforce things that when they appear in purely human interactions are clearly chosen and can be changed. But when they appear to be embodied in technology, often we're less likely to think that we can change them. We'll treat them as neutral, or we'll treat them as inevitable.
Can you give an example of that? You mean like
sure.
One of these gender issues?
Yeah, absolutely. So here's an example, and it's especially relevant to the HR applications of AI. So imagine that you have a decision support system, because we've been talking a lot about conversational interfaces, but there are a lot of applications. And maybe in some definitions we would want to say this is automation, not AI, but not everyone carves it out the same way. There are a lot of applications of AI that kind of happen behind the scenes where it's helping you make a decision. So imagine you have an AI system that's job is to examine applications or resumes submitted for a job and rank them and decide which of them you should actually interview. Now imagine that it's trained on data that is taken from records of promotions and salary increases within that given industry. Okay. And basically you say, tell me which of the candidates who've applied for this job are most likely to be successful in my company in this job. Okay. You guys can already see this, right? It's going to reinforce the existing gender and racial disparities that exist in the way people get promoted and the kinds of raises they get, whether they get raises and how big those raises are, whether they're given the kinds of signals to ask for raises within an industry. All of those, we know those gender and racial disparities exist. And what's going to happen is the AI system that's looking at your resumes is going to not just mirror those, it's going to magnify them and reinforce them. But then it's going to hand it back to you, and if you aren't aware of this, you're going to say, oh, well, this system is neutral and objective. It's a computer. It can't be biased, right? So this must be accurate, unbiased data about who I should interview. And what you've done is you've basically just sort of It's like money laundering, only it's bias laundering is what we call it, right?
Right.
And so we have to be incredibly careful about making sure that these technologies don't conceal and harden existing injustices and inequalities in our society that when they appear in purely human-generated form, we know we can change.
Right. And that example of hiring, I mean, there is existing legislation which requires treatment in hiring, but some people are thinking that AI technology may require new regulations, and certainly in the EU, where I guess you were going to be operating for a few more years, maybe. There is this new regulation coming through the GDPR, which includes a clause that gives people a right to an explanation of a decision made by an algorithm.
Yeah, that's right. So it's very much related to the design question we talked about earlier. It's not enough to design diverse and inclusive. It's great that we're doing that, but it's also equally important to realize that security, privacy, legal considerations are taken right in the beginning of the design process rather than as an afterthought. So in the data regulation world, as financial services, we have certain obligations. When people tell our bot information, they should not be telling it, because it may or may not be a human or a bot. Then that becomes a very tricky situation. And I love the botanist phrase, Amir, because it reinforces the point that bots exist. We need to embrace their botanist. They don't have to pretend to be human. And in the GDPR kind of situation, it is very, it's a big challenge, and we're working on how do you differentiate when you're talking to a human versus you're talking to a bot. A bot is transferring you to a human. How do you handle that data? And bots sharing information with other bots, and the security constraints that come up with it, it needs to be designed for that world, and it needs to be designed the right way. Also, whether users want their information to be mined, and this is a difficult problem, because sometimes when machines learn on their own, you might end up discovering information that you're not looking for. And how do you handle that? Because the user did not give you approval to look at certain things, but it just comes up. So we need to define processes around that. For us, we do create almost an auditable track record of how our AI is making certain decisions. And we believe it needs to be used more often, not only because you're regulated in healthcare or financial services, it should just happen. When a medical professional recommends something, we know they made the decision and this is why they did it. When Netflix recommends what's the next movie to watch, it's probably not that big a deal if you don't know how it came up with that conclusion. But when you're talking about financial data, medical records, machines making more interesting, more liable decisions, then you need to have that audit trail.
I want to take the conversation to like, how can AI help with all these, with major problems that we have in the world. So there's a very interesting startup called Zebra that bought 40 years of HMO X-ray images and taught AI to recognize image problems. And like, you send it an X-ray and it says an outcome. This is amazing. Like, we in the, where we live, I'm sure most of you can have access to a radiology with a little bit of money, but most of the world doesn't have that service. So AI could bring high proficiency services to all over the world. So just like Google opened up information to everyone and made a lot of social change, think of AI providing all these services that are now complex and belong only to the top of our society. Mm-hmm. And now that these services are gonna be available to everyone. So I think there's an interesting, we can take technology to both ways, into the negative way and to the positive way. And I really like your idea that, like, at the end of the day, I'm more worried about the human behind the AI, mm-hmm, than the AI.
Yeah.
I think that the human behind the AI should be good. Okay. And that's what we should worry about.
Okay. And then, so before we let these beautifully patient people over here ask a few questions, I was gonna ask each of you to maybe talk about the future. I think you've just done it, Amit, so you've had your turn.
Yeah.
Shannon, like,
yeah, I mean, to be honest, I do think that predicting the future of AI is a little bit of a fool's game, because we're so early, and all I think we can say is it's going to be everywhere, and it's going to be affecting everything.
Okay.
So that's my prediction. And also, we don't have to worry about robot overlords. So that's, yeah, so I feel pretty comfortable with
all
that.
Right.
But I just, with respect to the regulation, I'll make a prediction about that.
Oh, yeah.
That what we are going to be 10 years from now, if we're doing this right, we are going to have regulatory structures that are better than the ones we've had for the internet, for technologies that have emerged in the last 25 years. We didn't get that right. There's a lot of bad legislation on the books, right? The kinds of laws that were made governing the internet in the 80s and 90s were terrible, and they didn't adapt to changes in the technology fast enough. But having a sort of complete laissez-faire regulatory environment where anything can happen is also a terrible idea. So I think what we're gonna have to do is develop more agile forms of technology governance that involve more reliable stakeholder input and broader stakeholder input, and that can change and adapt more quickly and be more flexible. So my prediction is 10 years from now, we're gonna have more regulation that's more like that, because otherwise it's not gonna work.
Okay. Do you think?
Yeah, 5 years from now, where we see it is, it's going to be everywhere, but what we see it as, like Kriti and Amir mentioned, is in the form of automating a number of small tasks to a point where we will see other professions evolving to a much more creative, more thinking-oriented jobs, because you'll have so much more time to think and create, because that is an area that AI in the next 5 to 10 years cannot help with, where humans can really add value. At the same time, there'll be more different kinds of jobs created through AI. For example, one category that we have in our company is AI trainers, people who are, you know, looking at what the AI puts out and correcting it. So that's what we see at least in the next 5 years.
Okay, great.
Couple of points. I think people will stop abusing AI as much as they today. And secondly, I think the skill set needed for AI. Today it's highly specialized, but I believe in 5 to 10 years time it's gonna be similar to how web development evolved. In the early days, you're sitting there modifying HTML code, but in a few years from now, it will be a completely different skill set of people who will be coming on board to use AI and solving some of the biggest challenges that we face. And technology will evolve to solving bigger problems than just what we are trying to solve today, which is making expense reports better, but hopefully we'll solve bigger challenges. So we published our guidelines on how we design AI at Sage a few months ago, and I think in 5 years' time we'll be rewriting it completely to suit a non-technical audience.
Okay, great. Panel, thank you very much. Audience, thank you for bearing with us. Does anyone have a question?
Regulation, is there a example you're going to present or pilot where regulation has not been reactive but has developed this kind of like organic paired way with the technology outside of corporate driven regulation?
So that's a great question. I think the example that people tend to point to as maybe the closest thing to a good model for AI regulation is sort of the evolution, and by regulation, I don't just mean government regulation, although that's a part of it. I also mean sort of professional within the industry regulation. So people point a lot to the evolution of the medical profession, particularly in the United States and Europe, and the normalization of medical ethics and bioethics, the normalization of professional certifications and training to ensure appropriate skill sets and responsible use of medical science. One of the examples that people point to a lot is the way that in the early 70s, a lot of scientists came together at Asilomar and made an agreement together that there were certain sorts of biomedical technologies dealing with genetic engineering that they would sort of self-regulate and basically come together and say, okay, here's what we're gonna do and here's what we're not gonna do, the kind of internal moratoria that were developed. And though there are certainly problems with our regulatory system with respect to the practice of medicine, very few people would wanna go back to an unregulated medical profession or medical industry, right? And yet there's a lot of internal control as well within the medical profession. So the American medical profession can do a lot of the work itself as opposed to just putting all of the burden on lawmakers. So I think that there's an example there that at least we could learn from. It doesn't mean we want to adopt exactly that model. And the diversity of applications of AI will spread well beyond healthcare. So I don't think that we're gonna be able to, develop just one regulatory framework. But I do think we have some examples in the past of the way that professions have been regulated because of their impact on human welfare, right? Why have we so successfully regulated the medical profession? Because if we don't, people die and horrible things happen to them. And we'll very quickly realize that AI has that power as well, only magnified.
So how can we capture this kind of But we use a little bit, like you mentioned, Excel, or even the make use of the automation part, like macro, we can have a program. So how can we not like be obsolete, rather take advantage of the technology in the traditional business?
So I think if we do our job right, you won't need to learn about AI. AI will be the underpinning infrastructure for what services that you use in every aspect of your life. I usually ask this, can I ask the like them a question? How many of you use AI every day? How many of you use Google Search or Amazon every day? So all of you who use Google Search or Amazon every day, use AI every day. It's all based on AI, other many, many types of AI, and the tool set is very long, but like every time you click people who bought this also bought that in Amazon, that's purely AI driven. So AI is the type of technology where if it works right, it's transparent and you don't call it AI. You call it an amazing shopping experience. You call it a productive work day. So if we do our job right, then you won't say, oh, AI helps me a lot. You say, oh, that this awesome software. And that is where like AI actually strives to be.
And I think for specific industries, that if you want to think about technologies for your world, I recommend instead of thinking about here are some technologies like AI or mobile or social, think about the problems that you have. What are the inefficiencies in your business? It isn't just about being obsolete or not. What the challenges are? Is there a lot of redundancy? There's a lot of admin work that is very repetitive, and then you can decide what's the right tool for that. And the tool could just be a simple macro, or it could be some simple automation for workflow, or it could be reusing some of these smart technologies that Amir mentioned, or it could be something you need to design for yourself. But if we think about this is some great tech, let me see what I can do with it because I love playing with it, I don't think that's very productive.
In the context of recent political events and thinking specifically about how AI interplays with media, for example, Facebook giving you a newsfeed of things that you'd like to see, and thus creating less diversity as you're in echo chamber of your own favorite things, how does the development of AI in the future increase potentially things that you wouldn't want to see, things that doesn't seem right to be optimized?
It's like any other technology. You can use it either ways. It's nuclear weapons, it's drones, and whatnot. A lot of what we've seen with content is what people create themselves as well. So there are three different ways I look at it when designing AI. One is humans are creating this content. Humans are used to creating both kinds of data. But when you're building AI, creating certain filters so your data is clean or clean-ish and it's diverse enough, that's one important point. Second is creating, and it goes into the territory of controlling AI in some ways, even though for the ultimate experience you want it to learn on its own. But the reality is if you open it up to that world, it also learns really bad things. So we need to create certain filters on not learning those bad behaviors from the external world, because people will feed it new information. And thirdly, the actual design of how it's surfaced back to you. And there needs to be the right balance. It could be a combination of news from independent sources, plus sources that are from your network, and then validation of whether this data is being created by actual humans. Sometimes it's just written by bots. Quite often, who are creating and generating this content. So all of these things need to come together.
I guess just to add to what you said, and purely as a consumer, and I completely identify with that problem, but I also notice my behavior in going through that newsfeed and actually deciding I wanted to be open, but at the same time, I didn't want to belong elsewhere, and I wanted to, I relished more and more of my kind of content, and I started controlling it to a point where I decided that maybe this is not the right place where it recommends content to me, as opposed to, proper mainstream media where there is something, people have done some hard work around that, and you know, you get your facts from there. So that is purely as a consumer's point of view. I agree with Kriti. The best thing we can do is feed in as diverse sets of data as possible to ensure that responsibility in terms of creating content or decision making, that at least is taken care of.
Can I just add one more thing to that? I think we also have to recognize that as great as this technology is and as many kinds of problems as it can solve, the kinds of problems that it can't solve are these kinds of problems that are fundamental moral and political problems in our society that run very, very deep. And one positive spin on it is to say AI might cause some of those to become more visible. That in fact, in some ways, some of the ways that this technology will make things worse might actually make us more motivated to recognize those problems and do things about them. But the kinds of things that might need to happen, you know, might need to happen in our educational system, right? They might need to happen in the way we understand ourselves as a society and politically. So we need to have a lot of moral and political conversations that might be generated by this technology and some of the problems that it will cause. So I resist the sort of narrative that we should expect technology to fix social problems for us, but it can expose social problems, sometimes by exacerbating them, which I think we're seeing.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question. Go ahead.
Are there things that arise, maybe different problem sets, from machine learning that has too small a data set versus machine learning that has a massive global data set?
I think a larger data set, if you set it right, it's more diverse and more accurate. That's from a mathematical point of view. So if you have a big, big data set, you might compensate for a skewed small data set. So small data sets are much easier skewed than larger data sets. So as an AI engineer, I always like more data and more diverse data.
Maybe it's I can rephrase it better. What are the risks endemic to small data set machine learning, and do they differ from risks that are endemic to large data set?
Well, I think clearly you can have problems with small data sets that involve the magnification of local effects and the reliability of the data, right? The issue with global or larger data sets, the impulse to pull in as much data as possible, I think one of the risks, obviously, from an engineering standpoint is the old garbage in, garbage out rule, that if you're being less selective because you want more data, and so you've got poorly labeled data or poorly curated data or data sets that might have the same label, but they actually aren't, the label's not being applied in the same way, so you think you're dealing with the same thing and you're not. Like, those kinds of problems from an engineering standpoint can get very messy if you're just like, more data, I don't care what it is or who made it or how they labeled it, so.
Yeah, another thing is that like as the AI progresses, it evolves, so it changes, right? The more data you give it, the more opinionated it is on one or learn something this skill or that skill. So I've seen models that crash after a long data set, right? The data set that skewed the model too much to like an ineffective AI model. So you need to like go back to the old model and retrain it. So I really like the garbage in, garbage out, because you could really, really screw up an AI model with the wrong data sets. Just like teaching a kid, right? You can, it's very, very similar. Like, what is the first experience and what is your experience impacts the way you interact as an adult AI.
Yeah, and in some cases, it's not very easy to correlate a lot of data with good quality output. For example, what we do, which is every business is setting up their accounts completely differently in how they categorize expenses, for example. Coffee for a cafe would be a very different, coffee beans would be a very different expense to coffee in a workplace, and then you can't correlate the two with one machine learning data set. In fact, if you try to combine a lot of those together, you lose the value in providing a targeted service to one business. So it really depends on what you're trying to solve.
I can give an example, which is kind of funny. There was an AI that tried to determine causality. So they train it by giving it articles and outcomes of the characters in the outcomes. And then the AI had a very depressing day when it came to the realization that everybody dies. So every outcome, you'd give it an article and we'd say, oh, everybody's going to die. That was the derived outcome of every article, right? Because 100% of the people in, that are mentioned in articles die. So that's like the 100% outcome of any article. So understanding the data set and how do you train things like telling people that causality is associated with time solves that problem. But like you need to understand that very similar to what you said, like humans interpret the data and teach the machine to interpret the data.
I want to add another great example. A friend of mine did this experiment, fed a lot of videos and movie content to an AI, rom-com movies, and AI just assumed every date ends in a kiss, which is not true.